Well, praise the Lord again. Have your Bibles, go with me to 2 Timothy. I just want to read one verse, chapter 3, verse 1. Let me read it. This know also that in the last days, when? Say it again. In the last days, perilous times shall come. So what Paul said close to 2,000 years ago, speaking of the last days. Go to Matthew chapter 24. I'm reading from verse 4. Now this is an answer to the question that was asked. They asked the Lord, tell us what shall be the sign of your coming at the end of the age. And the Lord told them a couple of things. And I want you to pay attention. And I want you to agree with what the Bible says. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Has that happened? Come on, talk to me. It has happened, and it's happening. Verse 6, and you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. Has this happened? This happened, it's happening. For nations will rise against nations and kingdom against kingdoms, and there shall be famines and pestilence and coronavirus and Ebola and Nipah and so on and so forth, and earthquakes in diverse places. Has this happened? It's happened, it's happening now. Now listen, and these are the beginning of sorrows. Everyone looks so sorrowful. You go out, people are looking so sorrowful. You go into the marketplace, they're looking so sorrowful. You come into the church, they're looking so sorrowful. No, I don't think. You know how I spell COVID? COVID is corona disease. But this is how I spell it. COVID. Christ over virus, infection and death. Verse 9. Then shall they deliver you to be afflicted and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations and for my name's sake. Is that happening? Jesus Christ said these things will happen in the last days. And then shall many be afflicted or offended and shall betray one another, and you shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. Is that happening? Yes, it's happening. And because of iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall turn cold. Is it happening? Very much. But, listen, this is for you today. But he that endures to the end shall what? Which means we are going to not put up, but we are going to go through all this, all the difficulties, all the viruses, everything that's happening around us. My brother, my sister, we're going to be firm as a rock, and they'll be saved. You know, I tell you, it's worth going through all this when we see what we're going to receive in the near future. When we are blessed, when we stand and start to laugh, we look back and we will say, all that we went through, it's worth what we are receiving today. Amen? So they that endure to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom, now see what Jesus Christ said over here. He said, this gospel, because there are other gospels being preached. But he says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all the nations, and then shall come the end. When you therefore see the abomination of desolation spoken by the prophet Daniel, stand in the holy place, whosoever read it, let him understand. Now verse 16 says, when this happens, in other words, When the temple is constructed, it's about to be constructed, any time, any moment, it'll be over in a short time. When that begins to stand over there, then what happens? Antichrist gets into the temple and desecrates the place. When he does that, the Lord is speaking in verse 16. He says, then let them be in Judea, flee to the mountains, and let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house, but let them flee and let them run and let them go. And then it goes on to say in verse 21, and then shall be the great tribulation. In other words, my brother, my sister, when all this begins to happen, it's happening in the first 3.5 years from the first day of tribulation. Pastor, can you tell me when does day one start? I don't know. But I think we can figure it out. If I'm reading from verse 3 and came down all the way to verse 19, I feel we are there. We see wars and rumors of wars. We're beginning to see pestilence today, diseases. Do you know what's happening? One expert was talking, you can Google and check, by the name of Joe Rogan, R-O-J-A-N. Joe Rogan says, he says, the world is taking what's happening very lightly. They don't know the seriousness of it. Because they have estimated, if precautions are not taken, you can get close to about 50% of the world's population disappear. We are there. Now, when you look at the financial condition, you look at our own nation. Leave other nations. Look at our own nation. Don't think our nation is up over there financially, economically. They are touching rock bottom. I got a WhatsApp message that 10 banks have become 4 banks. They are merging the banks. And now they've already said that you can't draw out much money. Now there's a strong rumor that banks are going to go bankrupt. And it will happen because the stock market has come down. Not only is the stock market coming down, the globally, this is not the latest statistic, I'm talking about a week or maybe a little more than that, it has been losing $1 trillion because of the virus. What's happening today is worse than what happened 1 week ago, because markets are shutting down. No one is working. IT people are not working from their offices. They are operating from their homes. So we're looking around. Literally, countries are becoming like a ghost town. Everything is shutting down. Tell me if this is not the beginning of tribulation. Come on, most of us can agree to it. Because what I see happening today has not happened since I've been here a little over 60 years. I've not seen this. Now, my brother, my sister, if this is the condition, and if the economy drops globally, people will start to get ready for starvation. Don't think that famine because of no rain. Famine are caused by various other ways. There's a global famine right now. If you go to China, you can't get food over there because they are all locked indoors. So this is the condition of the world. And I was asking the Lord, I said, Lord, what is the word that you have for the church in a season like this? Now, I could have spoke some of the message. I could have just picked something and spoke something. But I made up my mind this morning is to warn us of the storm that we are already in. And we've just entered the storm. It's going to become more dangerous in the days to come. And my brother, my sister, if we're not prepared today, it'll be difficult for us to prepare in the storm. So I want you to listen to me this morning as we begin to get into the Word. And my brother, my sister, days are going to get bad. Trust me. It's going to get worse in the days to come. But I got a message for you from the Lord. I got a word for you. And I want you to listen carefully. Let's go to Genesis chapter 7, verse 16. And they that went in male and female, and all flesh as God commanded him. And then the Lord shut him in. Now look at that verse carefully. The Lord told Noah, he said, the end of all flesh has come up. And I'm going to destroy. My brother, my sister, I think God can do so much and nothing more. God's patience is all patient. But his patience also has an end. You can't try his patience. People cannot fool around with God because God is God. Amen? He can let a long rope, but not so long. So the Lord said, he says, I can't put up with this anymore. And it's the same. The Lord is looking down into the world. You know, I think Paul, when Paul was writing, you know, 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1, and this know ye, that in the last days perilous times shall come. I don't think Paul would have realized that we would last till almost 2,000 years if he had known the condition of the world today. Now God is looking down and he says, you people have frustrated my grace. You have taken undue advantage of my kindness. And now the Lord is looking out. Please let me make this clear. What is happening today? The virus that you see happening today, I'm 100% it's not from God. Amen? I've heard many say God is sending this virus. No. How can God, who is the one who came to do good, do bad at the same time? You can't do both at the same time. But on the other hand, God is looking down and he's looking at the devil having real fun. But the Lord says, I will allow it to happen. And God has allowed this to happen. God is not doing it, but he's allowed it to happen. And so we can look at the devil doing all this and the Lord is looking down. Now the Lord has come to a place where he's disgusted. And he said, the time has come. I'm going to take this person and that person and this person here and that person, and I'm going to take them up what we call the rapture. That's soon going to happen. Because I think, I mean, you can agree with me, we are tired of what we see happening for these many years. Can we begin to see Brother Ambi and Sister Prabhat that were so excited in doing what the Lord called them to do? And today those fellows came and say, you can't worship here. Oh, I will cause problem. You look at the Christians that have been martyred. I was reading in WhatsApp, and that's a true message. I mean, this man reported. He went on his bike, dropped his son at school. This is in North India. And he barely turned to come back home. He had about 10 guys waiting for him on the way. And they stopped him on the road. They had rods. They had chains at the end of it with locks. And they beat him up and beat him up. Fractured his ribs, fractured his finger, broke his head. And they kept on saying, now call on your Jesus. Now call on your Jesus. And they let him down half dead. He's admitted. He went to drop a son in school. The Lord is looking down, and as much as we are disgusted, the Lord is also disgusted because for 2,000 years, the church has been persecuted. The time has come. And now is the time that the Lord is going to take the church to a glorious place. And I'm excited, and so are you this morning, aren't we? Amen? But this little window that we have left, I don't know for how long. My brother, my sister, whatever it takes us to share the gospel, this gospel of the kingdom before the end comes, it's today. Let's not sit around and do nothing, because if we do nothing, we're answerable to God for doing nothing. Can you say amen, church? So the Lord said to Noah, he said, Noah, well, build this ark, Noah, and call the people in. Now, Noah never restricted the invitation only to his family. The doors were open for 1 week before it was closed. Anyone can come in. And whoever came in was safe. But only 8 people came in. And of course, you know, the scripture says the donkeys came in. Amen. So only the few people came in. And the Lord kept the window or the door open. And after 7 days, now listen, Noah never closed it. The Lord closed it. So I believe there's a time that is set for the Lord to close the door. But before he closes it, are you inside? Amen. But now, let me you know, go on. It says in the same book, in the book of Genesis, and I'm reading verse 6, chapter 6, verse 9. And then I'll go to verse 8. Verse 9. These are the generation of Noah. Noah was what? Just man, say it again. And was? In all his generations. Why? Complete. He walked with God. My brother, my sister, when I read that verse of scripture, I felt a chill run up me. And I had to check myself. I'm serious. Am I really walking with God? Or if I'm walking with God, what's my proximity with the Lord? Am I closely walking, or walking with Him far away? So the scripture says that Noah walked with God. Now my brother, my sister, until and unless we walk with God, we cannot be saved from the deluge. Amen? Noah walked with God. Now, if you read that verse very carefully, it did not say that God walked with Noah. Because God will walk with anyone who walks with Him. Get that clear? God is always wanting to walk with us, provided we walk with Him. So because Noah walked with God, God looked at Noah, and verse 8 says, and Noah found grace with the Lord. My brother, my sister, we do not take the grace of God for granted. The grace of God is given to people who walk with God. So we need to double check our lives today, this morning, before we leave this service. Because I want you to know, we leave those doors and you're walking into a deluge. You're walking into perilous times. You're walking into darkness. You're walking, you don't know who's walking next to you. Somebody who has the virus. But I tell you, when we walk with God, no viruses walk with us. When we walk with God, no fear walks with us. When we walk with God, no sadness, no sorrow, no depression, no oppression, no demonic power. Nothing walks with us, because we are walking with the Lord, and therefore the Lord walks with us. Amen? So the Lord said to Noah, he said, Noah, you found grace, Noah, not all the others, because you walked with me. But my brother, my sister, please listen to me this morning. What is the prerequisite for us to walk with the Lord? I may walk out from here and say, well, I'm going to walk with the Lord. But I need to follow the conditions. I need to follow the prerequisite. There are requirements. And the requirement is over here. I'm just looking at two things. Out of the many, I'm looking at two. Number one, the Bible says that Noah was a just man. My brother, my sister, this morning, we got to come to that place where I will realize and I'll begin to understand and I'm convinced that I have to be a just man. There's injustice out in the world. But in the church, there's justice. In the church, there are just people because they are people who walk and are just. Noah was a just man, and Noah was perfect in all his generations. Perfection. Now, I'm not talking about perfection in the sense that some people think what perfection is all about. I've heard some people say, and this is one of the doctrines, I guess, I believe, they believe, that until and unless you're perfect, you cannot go to heaven. And Brother Prince, unless you're perfect, you cannot take communion. Yeah. My brother, my sister, I'm not perfect. Anyone perfect over here? The only time I will be perfect is when I get to heaven. And the only perfect man is the Lord Jesus Christ. All of us over here, including myself, we are not perfect. But guess what? I'm walking in the direction of perfection. I'm perfecting my walk every step of the way. I'm trying to live a perfect life. This imperfect person is trying to live a perfect life. This imperfect person is trying to walk in the direction of perfection. That's what the scriptures mean. So we got to be perfect in the sense moving into perfection. We got to be just. And then we can walk with the Lord. Otherwise, we cannot. Go to chapter 5 of the book of Genesis, and I hope I get the right verse. I think it's verse 24, if I'm right. Chapter 5, verse 24. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him away. Enoch walked with God. Here was another man that walked with God, and this man lived long enough before he got a son. Now, his father was my grandson. His father was Jared. My grandson is Jared. Why, he'll get so indignant if I hear what I said. So, Enoch walked with God. Jared walked with God. Methuselah walked with God. And the generation after that walked with God. And they became the direct lineage of Lamech. Then comes Noah. And then comes David. And then comes the Lord Jesus Christ. And then comes the church. We come from that lineage. Amen. But I'm looking at this man that walked with God. And he walked with God for more than 300 years. And after that, the Lord looked down and said, Enoch, you walked enough with me on earth. Now I want you to come and live with me in heaven. If you want to live in heaven, start walking with God. There's no other way. You know, it's very sad. A lot of people think, you know, they're going to make it to heaven. But on that day, people will know who will make it and who will not make it. Amen. We got to be walking with God. Verse 13. Chapter 24, verse 13. But he that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. I can see a lot of people seated over here that have gone through a lot of turbulences in your life. You are being tested. You are being tried. And my brother, my sister, you are still in the presence of God this morning. But I want you to know, continue in the same way, because our end is soon coming. And my Bible says, he that endures to the end shall be saved. We are not going to give up midway. We are not going to give up our journey with the Lord. We will keep on walking, because my brother, my sister, it's not going to be for too long, because soon we will stop our walk and we'll be sitting with the Lord. Amen. So hold on a little more longer. For the Bible says, he that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. See, a lot of people now want to walk with the Lord because they want to be saved from the virus. Amen. If that is so, you can walk with Bruce Lee. But my brother, my sister, one of the reasons, out of the many reasons, one of the reasons why I should be walking with the Lord is because when I look at myself before I came to the Lord, I was deep in sin. There's not one righteous, no, not one. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You know, we were deep in sin. We were in misery. We were enslaved to the devil. We were destined to go to hell. We had no hope. We had no peace. We were in sickness and sin. But God Almighty sent His own Son, Jesus Christ, who came and took our place and became our substitute. And He died on the cross for you and for me, and has taken us from where we were and has placed us to where we are now. And now I look at myself and I want to thank God for the work of the cross and Calvary and everything that He did for me right from then at the cross. And today I look at myself having obtained a beautiful exchange. He took my place and gave me His place as far as righteousness is concerned. Now, if I know that, that gives me all the reason why I should walk with the Lord, not just to save me from a virus. So I'm walking with the Lord out of goodness, out of gratitude, thanking Him for Calvary, thanking Him for what He meant. And not only that, I'm walking with the Lord because I know that not only did He take me from sin and put me where I am, but He's going to also take me, He's going to take you into heaven, my brother, my sister, a place that we do not deserve. Why shouldn't I walk with the Lord? Amen? I have all the reasons to walk with the Lord. Now, when I walk with the Lord with an attitude like that, my brother, my sister, all the more God provides protection. How many of you need protection today? We all need. Anyone doesn't need? We all need it. Start walking. Start walking with God. And then you'll begin to see how God can lead you, how God can protect you, how God can take care of your needs. Let the stock market drop. Let everything collapse. Let everything fail. My brother, my sister, we are the people of Goshen. Amen? People in Goshen were a small group of people that lived in Egypt. And this group of people was looking at Egypt. While they were having darkness, these guys were having light. While they were having all the plagues come upon them, these guys were not having anything. We are in a spiritual Goshen this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. And finally, as I'm wrapping up, now is the time for us to get prepared. Now is the time for us to shape up. And we need to draw close to God. You know, sometimes we begin to think from what height the church has dropped. Because when I, you know, as far as I know, because I've been in church for almost a little over 30 years. Now when I say 30 years, I was in church much before that also. But I was in a different church. But now I'm in a church. I'm not just talking to El Bethel. Generally, you know, I grew up for the last 30 years or more in a Pentecostal church. And my brother, my sister, when I look at myself, you know, I'm talking about 3 decades ago, there was such reverence in the house of God. There was such fear, the fear of God. Not like how it is today. You know, today, there's no fear absolutely. People don't fear God. There's no reverence. Because if we have reverence, now this is not hitting out at anyone. I'm generally speaking, generally around the world. You know, if there was real reverence, we will be in the house of God 5 minutes before the service starts. Amen? We will be in the house of God. How many of you this morning have brought your mobile phones instead of the Bible? Don't put your hands up. You brought your mobile phone instead of the Bible. Sometimes I use my mobile phone instead of the Bible because maybe I forgot to carry the Bible to at a particular place. That's when I use the mobile phone to read my Bible. But I don't take it as an option. I'll go to church today. I'll leave my Bible aside. I take my phone because the Bible's on the phone. Now let me ask you a question. How many of you would say this is a holy phone? Come on. This is a holy Bible. This is not a holy phone. Because in this you get a lot of junk. A lot of rubbish. My brother, my sister, don't substitute this for your Bible to the church. Can everyone say amen? Amen. I'm not being too hard, but I'm talking about having the fear of God. We got to carry our Bible. Show the world you're a believer. And don't hide your Bible when you come to the house of God. Why should people think, you know, I'm a Christian, I'm a Bible-believing Christian. All the Bible up and walk to the house of God with your holy Bible. Leave the holy phone behind. Amen? I'm talking about the fear of God. Because what happens is, when we carry our phone to the house of God, thinking that I'm going to use this for a Bible, but you know what we are doing? We are texting somebody. I'll meet you at lunch today. Come on, some of you are laughing because I guess you're guilty. No, you don't do that in the presence of God. So the church has fallen from a great height. Oh, I tell you, when worship, thank God for the worship this morning. But I was sad we never had a hymn. Amen? Brother Chakraborty, you like hymns? Yeah, we need to have some hymns. We need to have worship where we get on our knees. We need to have worship where tears will trickle down our cheeks. We need to have worship where healing will flow into the congregation. We need to have worship where people will come under severe depression and go back with happiness and joy. So worship team, this morning, before we come into the house of God, spend time with the Lord at home. Because you cannot take people where you have not been. Can you say amen? 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 We cannot take people where we have not been. We are like a tour guide. We are taking people into avenues of divine truth. Why? We know it before we came here. We have been there before we came here. I like what one brother said once. He said, I've come here today to lead people in worship because I was in the presence of God yesterday and the Lord spoke to me and told me these are the songs I need to sing. We got to get our songs from the Lord. Amen? Not randomly. You know, maybe we'll sing this song. Maybe we'll sing God has got an army. Maybe, you know, this, that. No, that's random. But get it on your knees. When you begin to do that, healing takes place. You know, you see the power of God unleashed in this place. My brother, my sister, my prayer today is this church will come back to reverence. Amen? If I see somebody with a mobile, I take and throw it in the trash can. I mean, I'm not saying don't carry a mobile. Carry a mobile. But stop your texting. Stop chatting with people. We need to stop that in the house of God. in the presence of God. Amen. You know, I was in Malaysia preaching in one of the churches, and the pastor said, we're going to have communion. And people came to the altar to receive communion. This is in a Methodist church, a spirit-filled Methodist church, tongue-talking Methodist church. So they came to the altar to receive communion. And I was looking at them, and this is how they received. Now look at me. They put their fingers like this, and they put their hand like this. Almost every church in Malaysia. I was wondering why they're doing this. They are actually receiving Holy Communion, but with both hands. And the fingers were like this because the cup went there. And with such reverence, they had it. Oh, I tell you, when I was watching that, I knew these people had the fear of God. They knew what it is to reverence the Lord. So church, we're going to take a U-turn now, and we want to come back to that place where we want to see God do something over here. Can you say amen? Amen. If that happens, not if, when it happens, that's when revival starts. How many of you want revival? Amen? We want to see our families set free. We want to see something happen in our homes. Amen? We need to start from here. So number one, start walking with God. How do you walk with God? Be perfect and be a just person. Amen? Have the fear of God. Begin to learn to worship the Lord the way the Bible says we need to worship God. When we do these four things, start doing it from today, we'll see revival next Sunday. Can you say amen? 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 Shall we all stand, please? As I'm closing in prayer this morning, I want you to, in your mind, make up your mind. And I want you to say this morning, in the name of Jesus, from today, I'm going to change my walk. I was walking not the way I should be walking. Or maybe I was walking far away with the Lord. But I'm going to draw myself close. And from today, I made up my mind to walk with the Lord. If that's what you are saying, my brother, my sister, you don't even have to use sanitizer. If you want to use it for hygiene purpose, you can. But you know, people are so paranoid. Everywhere, sanitizers, masks. But I want you to know, some trust in horses, some trust in chariots, some trust in sanitizers. Some trust in mask. But we will? Say it again. We will trust in the Lord. Diseases can come, viruses can come with all that. But when you're walking with the Lord, nothing comes. Amen? They'll have to run away. They'll go far away from you. You can be in the midst of people that are afflicted with these viruses, but they'll not come close to you. John G. Lake put virus on his hand and they died in his hand. Those viruses will die as they come into contact with us. Amen. So I want you to decide today. This is for your good. You're not doing anyone a favor but yourself a favor. By saying, Lord, from today, I walked away from you, but now I want to walk with you. I want to walk with the Lord. From today, I've decided to be a person walking in perfection. From today, I decided to be a just person. From today, I've decided to walk the walk of righteousness. If the Lord is speaking to you today, I want you to make up your mind as we pray. And I want you to pray with me. If you have decided to do that, pray this prayer with me. If you're not, don't pray. Because the Lord will take you at your words. Amen? How many of you would decide to make that decision? Can I see your hand, please? Thank you. Thank you. Any more hands? Don't keep your hand down. It's dangerous. You can walk out and walk with something else. Yes. Keep your hand up as I lead you in prayer. Pray along with me. Heavenly Father, this morning I heard your word. Words that came straight from your mouth. And Lord, I want to become serious. For thy word says, choose ye this day whom you will serve. But I have decided, as for me and my household, we shall serve the Lord. Give me the grace, Lord. Give me the wisdom to walk in your ways. And from today, I have decided to walk with you as a person who is just and perfect and righteous. And I thank you, Lord, as I leave this building and as I walk out, that nothing else will walk with me but you, O Lord, from today until I see you. In Jesus' name. Now let's give the Lord a big clap. My brother, my sister, all the best. They're going to see things happen around you. But if God be for you, who can be? Father, we thank you once again for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your precious people. Lord, in spite of what's happening in the city of God, they have still chose to be in the house of God. And Lord, that they will continue, Lord, to be in the house of God. As the psalmist says of God, that we will dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of our life. Bless them as they go out. Bless them as they come in. Bless their sitting down, their standing up. And whatsoever they shall lay their hands upon, not only would it prosper, but healing will flow through their hands. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide upon each one of us this day and always. God bless you. And have a great day.